so sick right now. She's at home. I think she's standing up pretty. You can put that paper down there. Yep, you can stand up. You can start.
Hear these words from Psalm 145. The Lord is good to all he has.
Compassion
on all he has made. All your work. Praise you, Lord, your faithful people extol you.
They tell of the glory of your kingdom and speak of your might, so that all people may know of your mighty acts and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures through all generations.
Good morning and welcome to St. Giles Kingsway Church. My name is Isabel and this is Kaya.
We gather for worship today on this Palm Sunday. This is the last Sunday in the season of Lent. Lent is a period of 40 days, a time when we remember the trials Jesus faced on the way to the cross. This week is called Holy Week. It begins with a remembrance of Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. We remember on Maundy Thursday, the Last Supper he had with his disciples. We recall with sadness and gratitude his passion on the cross on Good Friday. We end the week with a celebration of Easter on Sunday. You are invited to come and participate in all those significant services this week.
Today is also a special
service.
As are our
children
help lead the way along with the praise team.
We are
thankful
for student
Pastor Timothy and
Yelda
as lead
us
as
in praises
as
Clark
is away today.
Everyone is invited to join us for lunch in the lower hall today. Following the lunch, we hold our annual congregational meeting. All are welcome to stay, as you will learn a little more about how our church is organized and led, but you do not have to stay for that meeting following lunch.
Of our members,
Eileen Crocker,
Jesus
turns
100 today.
Eileen
will
view
this service
online.
Online.
So let us show our
So let us show our love
and celebration.
And celebration.
Please stand with us for the opening responsive call to worship you see on the screen. Got this right here.
On this
Palm
Sunday, we
celebrate
Jesus'
entry.
Jerusalem.
Riding
on a
donkey.
Showing us the way of peace.
We affirm that God is at work when people are ashamed of the inhumanity of war and work for peace with justice.
We pray for peace,
who is the Prince of
Peace, the Lord of hosts, the King of Kings.
Please
stand for the opening
song.
Hosanna.
Loud Hosanna.
Loud Hosanna.
Thank you.
Let us pray. God of majesty and mercy, we worship today as the cross looms large on the horizon. We praise you for Jesus, the ruler who came in humility to free us from captivity.
He came in mercy to free us from the sins we recognize in ourselves and the sins we easily overlook. He came to show us the full extent of your mercy, love, and justice.
So we praise you for your kindness and the strength you show to lift our burdens and shoulder them for us in Christ Jesus. We come to know you have given us your all, and we are so grateful for your love.
So we praise you for your kindness and the strength to you show to lift our burdens and and shoulder them for us in Christ Jesus. We come to know you have given us all your all, and we are so grateful for your love.
God of mystery and mercy, your mercy and forgiveness are mysteries to us. We know we often fail to show mercy to others when they fall short of our expectations. We keep silent rather than speak up when others are in trouble. We prefer that is easy to what is right. Even though your Spirit points out our failing, we seek your forgiveness.
We ask that you make us more forgiving. Inspire us with the costly choices Jesus made as he moved to the cross, and give us courage to follow him. We pray in Christ our Lord. Amen.
Friends, hear the promise of forgiveness as we put our hope in Jesus the Savior. The Gospel of John, chapter 8, we hear these words: I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Friends, as we put our trust in the Savior, Jesus, know we can have confidence. We are a forgiven people, and thanks be to God. I'm going to invite, I should have told you, the kids participating, to come back up, and we'll just sit together up here for a couple minutes, and some of you are yet to participate, so you can come forward, and we'll just talk a little bit about Palm Sunday together. Did most of you get a palm frond? No, not many of you. So, who's the fastest runner of you two? What do you think? Huh? No one wants to brag. Isabel, run back, grab about 10 of these palm fronds, okay? Not mine. These are mine. Run back and grab about 10 of those from the back on the table. Miss Catherine will give you a bunch. All right, Isabel is running with the fronds. She's running up. There she goes. Oh, my. Watch your step. Good. You made it. So hand them around to whoever doesn't have one. This girl doesn't have one. We call today, and yeah, to Matthew and your sister, to John, you can give one. Yeah, give one to everybody, or you could even give a couple. Today is called Palm Sunday. Are these palm branches? Remember Heidi was bringing up a palm branch from the deep south that came up here into this area, a palm branch. What are these called? These little ones. There we go. That's okay. Do you know?
Palm
leaves. For some reason, they have a strange little name. You're right, though, John. These are leaves. They call them fronds. Have you heard of that? Palm fronds. So, not all of us got a big palm branch to kind of carry up to the front, but we have palm fronds. It's a little symbol of the celebration that today is. John's about to read the responsive psalm, right, John? And there's some interesting words in there. And one of the verses it says this with boughs in hand. That's another strange word. So bow is another word for a branch of a tree. With boughs in hand, let us join the procession. So when we were walking up today, the choir was walking up, that's a procession up to the altar. And so the choir and some others were leading the way up here for worship. And so that was written 1,000 years before the time of Christ, that a celebration bringing boughs in hand, leafy branches, into worship. Why do you think we do that, though? Anybody know? Why do we use leafy branches in worship? Anybody know? It's an ancient sign of celebrating a king. And it can be a king who sits in a throne, a human king. But for the Jewish people and Christian people, it's to celebrate God, God as king. And so Palm Sunday is a reminder of Jesus as king. And so Jesus came into Jerusalem on that Palm Sunday on a donkey riding into Jerusalem, and they were waving palm branches. In John's gospel, we hear that today. It speaks of the palm branches. Today is Palm Sunday. It's also called Passion Sunday. So it's Palm Sunday. We lift up the palms and we celebrate. Why don't we lift them up here and we say the word Hosanna, Hosanna. So look, the congregation is doing it too, see? Hosanna to the King. So it's praising God. It's praising Jesus as our Savior, Hosanna. But it's also called Passion Sunday, Passion. Jesus went to the cross, and we celebrate that later this week on Good Friday. Jesus died for our salvation. So today's a celebration, but it's not quite next Sunday. What's next Sunday? Easter Sunday, yeah. Resurrection Sunday, that's the real celebration. So today we celebrate, but there's that little bit of not quite yet. So thank you to the children for helping us lead worship today. All of you are playing a role in the praise team and choir, helping us sing joyfully. So let's take a little moment to pray, and then John's going to read that responsive psalm with us together. Let's pray. Lord God, we love you. And just in a little feeble way, maybe we feel even a little silly waving our palm frond, it's a reminder that we're here to worship you. It's not about us, really. It's about you, God. It's about you, Jesus. May you, God, know that we worship, that we love, we adore you. So bless these children as they lead the way in the hosannas today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, John, why don't you come over and lead us in the responsive song?
Open for me the gates of righteousness. I will enter and give thanks to the Lord. I will give thanks, for you answered me. You have become my salvation. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Lord, save us. Lord, grant us success. The Lord is God, and he has made his light shine on us. With boughs in hand, join the festal procession up to the horns of the altar. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, he loves and endures forever.
This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You can stand as you're able. Stay standing for the second hymn.
Life frees me to Today's gospel reading is from John chapter 12, verse 12 to 19. The next day, the great crowd that had come for the festival heard that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. They took palm branches and went out to meet him, shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel." Jesus found a young donkey and sat on it, as it is written, "Do not be afraid, daughter Zion. See, your king is coming, seated on a donkey's colt." At first, his disciples did not understand all this. Only after Jesus was glorified did they realize that these things had been written about him and that these things had been done to him. Now that the crowd that was with him when he called Lazarus from the tomb and raised him from the dead continued to spread the word. Many people, because they had heard that he had performed this sign, went out to meet him. So the Pharisees said to one another, "See, this is getting us nowhere. Look how the whole world has gone after him." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. We have entered Holy Week, sometimes referred to as Passion Week, as we journey, as we read the accounts in all the Gospels of Jesus walking to the cross. All four Gospels, they don't cover all the stories and the parables and miracles and signs of Jesus, but they all focus on this day, this week, Holy Week. It's the highest occasion in the Christian calendar year. Many people kind of think, oh, Christmas, that's when we get the most gifts. Yeah, I know. Maybe the biggest meals and parties. But for Christians now, Holy Week. And as I've said with Palm Sunday, it's a celebration, but it comes along with a heaviness. But not quite yet. Yes, we know that Christ went into Jerusalem, that he did die, that he rose from the dead. We know of the triumph of the resurrection, but in a way we step in to this moment in Jesus' life and ministry. Remember the weight on that Palm Sunday. We've extinguished a candle each Sunday through the season of Lent, and so we'll extinguish the last of the Lenten, the purple candles, and then the Christ candle. Jesus said, "I am the light of the world." That remains lit. But even that candle, if you're here on Good Friday, we extinguish that when we have that reading when Jesus died on the cross. And we look forward to the celebration, the triumph of Resurrection Sunday, Easter Sunday. Let's take a moment to pray. Lord, it's hard to, maybe it even feels a bit for the children as I talk about this, almost pretending that we don't know the whole story. When we talk about Palm Sunday and we talk of that, oh, wow, we know Jesus was walking to the cross, that he'd be mistreated by his dear friends and followers. He'd be crucified. It sort of maybe seems strange, but we know what happened. Yes, we do. But as Christians, we enter into this season, this Passion Week, once again, remembering, in whatever little way we can, remembering and experiencing just a little of the weight that Jesus carried on his shoulders. Not just that heavy wooden cross, but the weight of somehow all of our sin and brokenness. The weight of our distance from our Creator on his shoulders as he walked to the cross to pay for us all. And so we remember. We give thanks in the name of Jesus. Amen. wanted to talk a little about something that I think all of us have. Many of us have it right now on your person. I don't know about some of the younger children, but almost all of us have keys, right? We have keys. You have a key for your car, unless you're very energetic on this wintry Sunday and decided to walk or bike today to church. You have a key for your home. Maybe you're one of those people that has one of those key rings with like 18 keys, all your office keys, when you visit family, friends, maybe you have a key to the church or various keys to the church, the big weighty key ring. But I wanted us to think and talk a little about keys. Now I'm interested for our children today, how many of you have a key? It's a bit of a responsibility to have a key. If I could see children's hands, and children, you can define yourself, whoever is considered children. It can be youth or further. So how many of you have a key? Really, we haven't given you one yet, Lindsay? We should get on that, right? Most of her sisters have a key because, Matthew, you've got one. What about those Diskin kids? Do they have a key? No, they're not keepers of key. It's a big responsibility, isn't it, having a key? The key was made for a purpose. The key was made so that when you come to your home, you're entitled, you're allowed to go in there. It's, in some way, your home. The key was made for this church. Oh, we're putting up the big screen key. That's okay, let's throw it up there. So this was a key, not the exact key, but pretty similar. When we go up to Tadoussac, Quebec in the summer, there's a church that was set up in Tadoussac, Quebec in the mid-1800s. And I get to walk over as the keeper of the key when we're there and open the church door with this huge key. And it's really, really neat looking. I don't know if anybody has any of those keys. Probably not for your home or a filing cabinet or your office, but those are pretty neat keys. That's a hard one to lose, right? That's the good thing about that. It's not like when I'm looking through my keys at Tadoussac, which one's the church key? No, that's the only one, right? That's the church key, the big key. Keys are important. It's kind of like in our digital age of passwords, right? How many passwords do you now have to remember for all your various accounts, and you don't want to write them down in case someone steals that? Keys. We have many passwords in our minds. We have many keys in our pocket or in our home. Keys. But the thing is, there's many keys that we don't know what they're for. I did a little look through in a little cabinet by our front door at home, and I found a bunch of keys, and they're in this little plastic container here. There's about a dozen keys, and then these ones were from the church office. I asked Beth, just scout around in your own office, how many keys do you have that you don't know what they're for? And this is how many in the office, maybe about 15 keys, you know, in the office floating around. We're not really sure what they're for. And even in the entry to the home, the church manse, we have all these keys. And I don't want to throw them out because they were made for a purpose, right? They have a reason for their existence. And many of us have a drawer, right? If you admit it in your kitchen or somewhere near the front door and you open up and there's like 15 keys and you're like, someday I'm going to go through and find the location for each one of these keys, right? You're going to take it, go to every door, filing cabinet, your relatives' homes, and try all these keys and find why they were made. Most of us don't ever do that great spring cleaning exercise, but maybe I've encouraged you to do that. What are these keys for? And we don't want to throw keys out. Like, I like keeping things sort of neat and tidy. I want to toss those keys. I really do. Some of them were in our house before we moved there, right? So I surely they don't still have a purpose. I want to throw them out. But when we do, that's the time, right? It's like, oh, wait a second. My mom had given me her grandmother's jewelry that I put in this little safe inside a filing cabinet under the stairs at my home. And I needed that key, and I threw it out. And unless you have a locksmith like Greg McFarlane nearby, wait, where is he? Oh, I'm used to seeing you there, Greg. Where'd he go? He was in the at the back. Unless you have a Greg McFarlane, you're in trouble. How do you get in to that safe, that door? Keys are important. Why am I talking about keys? Why am I bringing this into Palm Sunday? Well, let's think about that passage we read, John chapter 12, one of the four Gospels telling of Jesus' entry into Jerusalem. The context, kind of the background for that, is that Jesus had just performed a great sign. John's Gospel calls them signs, but we often say miracles. Jesus had performed this miracle. This man Lazarus was dead. And in chapter 11, we see Jesus come to the town of Bethany, and that's very close to Jerusalem. And Martha and Mary, Lazarus' sisters, are really angry at Jesus. If you had been here, Jesus, he wouldn't have died. My brother wouldn't have died. And Jesus says, and we'll put that up on the screen there, John chapter 11, verse 25, Jesus told Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, even if he dies, will live. Wow. Powerful. Now, as Christians, we think, oh yeah, he's talking about the final resurrection. But no, actually, in John chapter 11, Lazarus came out of the tomb. He'd been there for days. And Jesus' voice of command, Lazarus, come out. And Lazarus comes out like a mummy. Many of you have seen a movie with a mummy, right? All wrapped up. And Jesus said, take off the grave cloths. Let him go. Release him. He's alive again. See, Lazarus was like a walking billboard for the power of Jesus. Lazarus was walking around, and so many people were at the funeral. Everybody was there in the town of Bethany. And they were so sad. He was fairly young. His sisters, Mary and Martha, were grieving. And now he's alive. And he's walking around it, and many people were celebrating, but some were like, ugh, we wanted to get rid of Jesus. They wanted to kill Jesus. Jealous of Jesus' power, fearful of how the world, Jewish society, would change if Jesus was the Messiah, the promised one. They wanted to kill him, and they wanted to kill Lazarus too. This walking advertisement of Jesus' power over even death itself. So the crowd, when we think about that Palm Sunday, this happened just before. So John chapter 12 we read today, Jesus is coming into Jerusalem, and many people are coming, we're told, because they heard about it, or they knew, or they saw that Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead. So they were coming, and they were celebrating with palm branches waving. They believe this might be the Messiah. But many people were angry and wanted to kill him. The crowd was mixed. Those words that we heard read today were words, Hosanna, which actually the Hebrew meaning is, Lord, save us, save us. It's an exclamation of praise, to be sure, Hosanna. They were praising, but there was this weight of, and we need saving. We need saving. Oh God, may you be the promised King of Israel. Set us free. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Those words from Psalm 118 recited by them. Lord, save us. Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Jesus came riding in on a donkey, and I'm putting lots of the scripture verses up today just for all of us, but for the children as well, just to see the connection between what Jesus did and the fulfillment. So the next slide there has Zechariah. So it's an Old Testament prophet, chapter 9, verse 9. And Zechariah spoke these words, rejoice greatly, daughter Zion, speaking of the people of Israel. Shout, daughter Jerusalem, see your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly and riding on a donkey. Jesus, throughout most of his ministry, he kept telling people, don't make a big deal. Don't tell everybody what I've done. He kept a low profile, but finally, things changed. Finally, Jesus began to say, I am the resurrection and the life. I am the one the prophet Zechariah spoke about. He took that donkey to show those who knew the scriptures what he intended. I am the one riding in, having salvation, righteous, victorious. The disciples didn't understand everything then, but after his glory, after his resurrection, they realized what he did and the prophetic words spoken. Friends, Palm Sunday, celebration, but muted, not quite yet. Hosanna, not hallelujah. Hallelujah is that full-throated praise God, praise him in the highest. We're going to say hallelujah. How many times in the hallelujah chorus? The choir's going to lead the way. I'm sure someone's counted, right? But it's got to be like hundreds. I don't know. We're going to say hallelujah a lot. We're not supposed to say it today, even though I just said it a bunch of times. Today's Hosanna, Hosanna. It's this, yes, we have hope. The Messiah is at work. The Messiah is being revealed, but not yet. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You know, in our church, in the original sanctuary, we call it the Iona Chapel now, we have many of the original windows still there along the lower part of the building. But the upper windows were taken out, I don't know, maybe 5 years ago. They're very heavy. I think it's kind of lead or heavy iron around the panes of glass. They were taken out because there was a lot of problems. They were kind of flopping open and some of the panes were breaking. You might even see that one's broken there. So, and they were getting very hard to replace. These 1950 windows aren't being made like they used to be, right? But as I just walk up, and for the children and all of us, you can see there's a problem with these windows. Can you see me through the windows? You might see, like, if I move around, you can see a figure kind of moving behind, but you can't really see anything through them, right? And so as a church, I'll just bring it back a little further for you folks. As a church, we thought, just are they starting to break and kind of fall apart a little bit? But it's nice to see people, right? If you guys can't see me through there really, right? Now they're clear, bright windows, and we can see well. There's this passage that Paul, the apostle, writes about in his letter to Corinthians. We'll just put that up. And I put it in the old King James Version, which is, okay, then, yeah, the King James there. Paul says, for now we see through a glass darkly or dimly. We can't see clearly, but then, face to face. Now, he says, I know in part, but then shall I know, even as I am known. Palm Sunday is sort of like looking through a glass darkly. Can't quite get it. The people saw Jesus, they were shouting words of hopefulness. But the terrible and sad thing is those very people shouting words of praise said, crucify him. 5 days later, they were seeing through a glass darkly, not face to face, not fully, not clearly, not perfectly. And here's where I connect to the keys that I was talking about. You see, the key to the kingdom of God was right there in their midst. But they couldn't quite see him yet. He was the one who could unlock life with God, enter the kingdom of heaven, but they didn't see the truth right there. They were looking through a glass darkly. Luke chapter 17, verse 20 and 21, we'll just put that up. Jesus said, not long before the Palm Sunday entry, the coming of the kingdom of God is not something that can be observed kind of with human eyes, but because the kingdom of God is in your midst. Jesus was speaking of himself. The kingdom of God is among you right now in Jesus. We journey to the cross. We remember how, in a sense, they looked at that key, and they didn't know where it fit. It didn't seem to make sense, and they cast the key away. Hosannas became crucify him a few days later. And we're quick to judge them, judge the people of that time. How could they not recognize Jesus? How could they not see him? But do we do this same thing as Christians? Jesus' power and glory is revealed in the world today. Many of us have those encounters where we know God acted without a doubt. And yet, as time goes on, we begin to try to rationalize it and try to mute the mystery because we prefer to have what we understand, what we can touch and feel. We lean on our own wisdom and turn away from the mystery. The Lord Jesus says we must receive the kingdom of God, the key to the kingdom of God, like children. Friends, the good news is those who cast the key away, they tried to bury him, but this key would not be bound by death, by sin, by hate. Our final slide in Psalm 118, we read it already today. We'll see it again. The stone the builders rejected, the stone they cast out, the key cornerstone, that has become the chief cornerstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. The giver of life, the key to the kingdom of heaven, could not be held back. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. We come to God through faith in him. Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Let us pray. God of courage and compassion, as we follow Jesus toward the cross this Holy Week, we give you thanks that he faced his enemies with courage, not violence. We are grateful he loved us enough to die for us, bearing every pain and sorrow others inflicted. In Christ, we trust that your love has power in every situation, even the most troubling or tragic. So hear us as we bring to you the people and places facing trouble and tragedy this day. We think in particular of all who struggle with poverty, sickness, or grief. We pray for those who are feeling overwhelmed by life situations beyond their control. We pray for those who are grieving the loss of a loved one. We pray for all people in the nations that have been constantly engaged in political unrest, persecution, and unjust attacks. We think of nations in Africa, the Middle East, and Eastern Europe. God, you are the God of all nations. In the midst of great turmoil and unrest, may leaders surprise by seeking the ways of mercy, peace, and forgiveness, and turning away from the enticing grip of greed and lust for power. May healing come. May you, Almighty God, make your presence known to those who suffer. May you, Jesus, the Prince of Peace, make your name known. May you, Holy Spirit, be a guide and help to those who call on you in the hour of need. By the light of the gospel message, we know Jesus Christ died for us to ransom all who are oppressed. We pray all these in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Stand together, please.
Power, our God, our God. beside you, all around you, and within you. He is with you, he is with you, in the morning, in the evening, when you're coming and you're going, and you're weeping and rejoicing. He is for you, 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 he is for you.
Friends, if God is for you, who can be against you? May the grace of Jesus, the tremendous love of God our Father, the comforting presence of the Holy Spirit, remain with you all this Palm Sunday, this Holy Week, and forevermore.